What's going on, guys? Okay, so I will ask of something from you guys is this, is if we can come to the front, come to the altar, just to spend time up here during worship. So I ask that you guys get out of your seats, come to the front. And before we get started with worship, I just want to spend just a couple of minutes in just time of prayer and really just asking the Lord to just have his way in our service, okay? So please come to the front, come up in this area right here. And then if you can, Tim, just dim the lights a little bit. And Christina, if you don't mind, let's just play a little bit of worship music as we pray. All right. So first and foremost, before we even get started even with prayer, my question that I'll ask you guys is this, and is why are you here? Right? You could have just gone to go eat. You're in Houston. We've got a great diverse culture of food here. We have a mall. We have all these things. Why are you here? Why did you stay or why did you come back? And I only ask that because I remember being at y'all's age, having a pastor ask me to come to the altar during time of worship or staying for the youth session. Like, why? But it wasn't until I got a little bit older where I understood that there's nothing else in this world that truly matters than being able to spend time and growing in my relationship with God. For many of you guys, I'm just going to call it as it is. You've gone years probably without having a real relationship with God. And as honest as I can say, I can look in the room to know who's had an on-fire relationship with God. Or for many of you guys who are just here because your parents dragged you here. And for many of you, you probably heard this. Your parents are like, I'm bringing you to this conference. Why? There's this pastor named Pastor Sam, and he's young. You'll like him. Well, for many of you guys, you're like, oh, this is that guy, right? And for many of you guys, what I can share with you from my heart is this. There's nothing about me that there's a wow factor. The only thing about me that really brings that wow factor is the relationship that I have with God. And for many of you in this room, that's one of the things that I feel that can be the change in your life is many of you feel like you don't have a true identity or don't know who you are, but most of it is only because you lack that relationship with the person who's created you. And so during this time, before we even get started with worship, I want to just start out in prayer. And I want you guys to really just, with your honest heart, talk to the Lord. For some of you, that honest conversation with the Lord is, God, I don't even know when the last time I talked to you was. And God, to be honest, I don't even know if you have a calling on my life. Why not be real with God? Why pretend and just say, Lord, do something good. Amen. Because that's many of our prayers. Why? Because we lack the vocabulary in praying to our Heavenly Father because you don't do it. But with what you can say with your heart is, Lord, I really am struggling having a relationship with you. But I ask, Lord, that today in this service, make it known to me that you're real and make it known to me that you love me. And that's all that I ask from you guys. And that's honestly all that have that kind of relationship where we know that he loves us and that we know that we can depend on him. And that's it. That's all. That's all that it is. So in this moment, I'll even ask, you know, Christina, just to bring it down just a little bit. Praise team, don't even get started because many of you on stage, you might have the same conversations right now, even myself. So take this moment to be honest with your relationship with God and speak to him. And as the Lord moves, as the Holy Spirit moves, we'll then go ahead and get started with worship. But now I'll be honest and say the most, probably the realest thing you'll hear in church, and this is from me, is there's no point in moving on with our schedule if we don't experience God. Because if we did, without experiencing God or feeling his presence or knowing his presence is here with us, we'd do a disservice. What difference would it make from you going to Austin City Limits or any other concert or the world tour that Taylor Swift's throwing? There's no difference. You'd just be singing songs that you think you know, and you'd be raising your hands just like every other concert you could go to be honest. And you'd go home thinking, what a great experience. And guess what? You'll forget about it. If that's how you have been doing church all your life, as a pastor, I want to say I'm sorry on behalf of every other leader who hasn't led you into his presence. And that's just me being honest and saying it from my heart, is I don't want to be a leader that can't lead the next generation into understanding his presence. I don't want to be a leader who does a disservice to the Lord because I cop out and choose to hinder the Lord to move because I'm too embarrassed or too ashamed of what he could actually do. No, I'm not that leader, guys. I'm not, and I refuse to be that leader. Because if I was to cap God with what he could actually do, because I didn't want you guys to be introduced to something that you might be afraid of or any of that, if I did that disservice to the Lord, you know what that would say? That would say that I'm ashamed of truly who the Lord is. I'm not ashamed of him. I'm not ashamed of his Holy Spirit. I'm not ashamed of his power and his presence. I'm not ashamed at all. That's actually what gives me the boldness to talk about God. That's actually what gives me the boldness to want to testify about his goodness. And for many of you in the room, this might be the first time you're hearing God being talked about like this. You're used to, okay, everybody, welcome to Sunday school. Please open up your Bibles to this chapter. All right, we're done. See you at lunchtime. See you next week. But I want you to truly encounter God and have a real relationship with him, to when you go home after this, it wasn't that you just got on fire at conference, but you learned to be in his presence every day by yourself. Amen. You and God. You don't need a pastor to be there with you in that moment to talk to God. You can talk to God in that moment. Come on. Have an honest conversation with the Lord right now. Lord, we give this service to you. Have your way. Do what it is that you want to do in this service, Lord. Lord, I ask that you just infiltrate and invade the hearts and just this room, Lord. Lord, we just want you. There's nothing else. Just you, nothing else. Lord, we're not here to just mingle and have fun, Lord, but we're a generation that wants to know you truthfully. We're a generation that wants to know that there's power and authority in your name. That our friends or even ourselves who are dealing with depression and anxiety, Lord, we can call on a name. We don't have to only take medications, but Lord, we can be healed of those things. We can be set free from those things. That the generation and the title that people have claimed on this younger generation is not what we are, Lord. No, we're your children. We're not defined by the world, but we're defined by you, Lord. And so, Lord, right now, as every heart in this room is having that conversation with you, Lord, we ask that you reveal yourself to everybody. Reveal yourself to everyone in your word. Reveal yourself to everybody in just your presence right now. Holy Spirit, you have free reign to speak and to move in this place. Let us get out of the way, Lord, and just do what it is that you want to do in this place. I even feel right now the Holy Spirit's putting in my heart that some of you right now are going to feel his presence even right now in this prayer. Why? Because this is the first time that you've been genuine before the Lord to really offer him a sacrifice. And that sacrifice is you. And you're saying to yourself right now, I feel these are the words that the Holy Spirit's putting in my heart that many of y'all are saying is, Lord, I'm just lost. I don't know who I am. I feel like I don't fit in. I feel like I go to school and I'm the only person that notices myself. I feel like the Lord is really just speaking in this moment that you have an identity. You have a purpose. But you'll only find that through me. Move, Lord. Move, move, Lord. Move. Fill me up. Lord, have your way during this time of worship.
Fill me up until I overflow. Fill me up. I wanna overflow. till I overflow. I wanna run.
I've been held in your hands. All my life.
as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens. As your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens. As your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens. As your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name.
Come on, just sing it out to the Lord. Come on, just sing about how worthy He is. Come on, just the voice is worthy. And worthy is your name. Come on, sing it out. Jesus, you deserve. And worthy is your, worthy is. You know, as we were singing this song, I just felt just the Holy Spirit putting it in my heart is how many of you are willing and understanding to give Him this true praise and talk about His worthiness. How many of you in the room understand when you say, worthy is your name, Jesus? Well, when you're saying or singing, worthy is your name, you're saying that there's no other name that compares to His name. You're saying that there's no other thing in your life that compares to Him. And if you could sing that with all of your heart, if you could sing that from the depth of your soul, that only He is worthy, only He is worthy. I promise you, you're gonna feel an increase in your life when you can tell yourself and when you can say it with your own words, Lord, worthy is your name. Worthy is your name, Lord. Come on, just sing it out. And worthy is your name. Come on, just you guys. Be the cry of your heart. Let this be the cry of your heart. Worthy is, and worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve. And worthy is, come on, worthy is, and worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Let's sing, be exalted. So be exalted
now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above.
Now in the heavens,
as your glory fills this place, you alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens, as your glory fills this place.
there's a newfound hunger that's going to be birthed into your life. A new hunger for the Lord that's about to be birthed into your life. Those that are crying out to the Lord, those who are telling the Lord, Lord, I need you more than everything else in life. There's a new birth of hunger for him in your life right now. He's moving in this place. For those that are wanting more of God, you're going to experience him in a way that you've never experienced him before. To hear his voice clearly, to be led by the Holy Spirit. Come on, let that hunger just cry out right now. Just sing worthy. And worthy is your
name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name.
God, worthy are you, Lord. God, and we thank you in advance for what you're about to do in this place. Lord, our hearts are expecting, our hearts have we're ready, Lord, for what you're going to do. Lord, have your way, Lord. We thank you in Jesus' name, amen, amen. All right, y'all, if we can, let's try to maybe sit in the first three rows of each side if y'all want, or you can have a seat right here. I'm fine with that too, on the floor. That doesn't bother me at all. I've been waiting for this moment, and I feel like for many of us, I probably have not seen you guys in over a year, so it's good to have you guys here. It's good to be able to speak with you all. And for some of you guys that don't know who I am, I'm Pastor Sam, and I'm one of the pastors here at the church. I've grown up here in the church, and I've had probably the best experiences with God here at VBC Houston, not just because I'm a pastor here, but growing up here, something that I was blessed with was that the Lord was always allowed to have his way here at our church since I've been here. And since I've been born here, and I thank God for what he's done in my dad's life, and also I thank God for what he's doing, you know, in our church's life. And one of the things that I do feel like the Lord wants me to share with you all tonight or this afternoon, it's important for us to understand, it's important for us to know. And as I look in the room, there's a bunch of us in here, there's a good amount of us in here, there's many of you all who I believe have yet to truly experience a real encounter with God. And for many of you in the room, most of that stops you from being able to encounter, experience God fully is because something that you've done. And it might have been, and I'm not talking about sin. I'm not talking about you having this lifestyle that's not what I'm talking about. I think the thing that stops you from encountering God fully is your words. For many of us, you'd say stuff like, oh, this ain't for me. Raising your hands, nah, that ain't for me. Singing worship songs, that ain't for me. Oh, look at them falling on the floor, that ain't for me. And we say these things without even knowing that it stops or it grieves the Lord from being able to allow the Holy Spirit to move in your life. And for many of you, I'm making a little bit of a guess or an assumption in this room that if you're coming to this conference and if your parents have brought you to this conference, either one, your parents or leaders that brought you, they know who the Holy Spirit is, and two, you might come from a church that believes in the Holy Spirit also. But I'm not going to say that for everybody because I've known in the past that people have came to our conferences and they're just wanting to seek more of God, but that's not what happens at their church as far as the Holy Spirit's movement and the freedom that we have here at our church. Now, something that I want to share with you guys and is my testimony that the Lord's been using me in the last month here at our church. And it's been an incredible journey. It's been something that I did not even think that the Lord was going to do. Tim, do you mind turning on the center aisle lights right here? I didn't expect for what the Lord was going to do. I didn't expect that the Lord wanted to use me or how he was going to use me. I was actually unsure that the Lord could use me. And I hope that that speaks to your life right now, is because many of you probably are in the room and you are saying to yourself, or you've said to yourself, I don't know if God wants to use me. I see other people in my, you know, Sunday school class or in my church, and the Lord's using them, but I'm not sure if he wants to use me. And something about that is even the words that you're speaking out of your mouth, it grieves the Holy Spirit, or it stops the Holy Spirit from moving, because what you're saying with your mouth is what you're going to believe in your mind. And the reason why I think that that's so true is because when you're singing worthy with your mouth, you can sing words without really allowing it to really penetrate into your mind. But when you're singing words that come from your heart, your whole body has to really show what it is that you're singing if it's coming from your heart. And for many of you in the room, I believe that the Lord's trying to do something incredible in your life, something new in your life, but it's going to start with your words that you're saying to the Lord. For me personally, what the Lord's been doing, It's wild. For those that know the story that I've shared with you guys many times, and I feel like the Lord uses me in a particular way where a lot of y'all's pastors are like, man, Pastor Sam, he's a young pastor, so what we're going to do is bring him in to speak to the young people. And I'm like, okay, like, yeah, I guess so. Like, that's probably what makes sense. And so that's something that I've been doing for, I guess, 8 years of my life, is I've been used in a way to speak to the younger generation and speak to churches, youth groups, and see their lives get changed. And then the Lord decided that he wanted to change something up completely in my life, where for the last month, I've been leading our church, mainly the adults, really the Vietnamese adults, into a deeper relationship with God. Was I scared? Yes. Did I think that I wasn't the person to be used? Of course. I said to myself many times, I'm nothing compared to Pastor Khan. I'm nothing compared to my dad. And I allowed my words to really dictate my thoughts of what God could do with my life. And I think for many of us in this room, when you understand that your tongue has the power of life and death, you could speak curses over your own life, you could speak curses over your own future by just saying, I don't think that God wants to use me and I can't be used. Or I don't think God loves me. Or I don't think God has a purpose for my life. And for many of us in our deepest, darkest moments of truly feeling lifelessness or hopelessness, we say those words. I don't think that God loves me. Because if he loved me, then I wouldn't be going through what I'm going through. And most of the times that we go through these feelings, we're in this really insecure moment of our life where we've broken down to the point of really hitting rock bottom. And for many of you that I've spoken to, some of us have found God in those moments. And some of us actually have turned away from God in those moments. And for me, something that I've learned and something that I hope that the Lord will allow today during this service is that your mind would be open to understanding that it doesn't matter how old you are. It doesn't matter what you honestly think about yourself. All that matters is what the Lord knows about you. And he's created you. And the reasoning behind all of this is I feel like the Lord's put a fire in my life. Yes, for the younger generation. Yes, specifically for those that are pastors' kids. How many pastor kids are in the room? Raise your hand. Not like, don't be shy about it. Like, just raise your hand. Jeez. Come on, raise your hands. Okay, pastors' kids. All right. All right, great. so all y'all will understand when I say, many of y'all probably said to God, I don't want to be a pastor because my dad's a pastor or my mom's a pastor. I've seen what they go through. They don't make money. They drive Honda Odysseys or something, you know? Toyota Camrys. That's not what I want in my life. It's the truth. That's what I used to say. Dad's at church every single day. Do I really want to be at church every day? And I grew up enjoying going to church every day. But I remember growing up and seeing my dad leave for church every day, come home and I was already asleep, wake up and someone called him to go pray for somebody in the hospital, and I didn't see my dad. Family vacations during that time were like, oh, dad got asked to go speak in Pensacola, so it's a family vacation to Pensacola. But it was really ministry. I got duped. Yeah, some of y'all got duped. Y'all are like, we're going to Houston. It's going to be fun. Psych, we're going to a conference. Some of y'all drove 7 hours from Pensacola. You're wild. Should have flew. Spirit Airlines is cheaper. I think that for many of you in the room that are pastor's kids, that God wants to bring a breakthrough in your life, because what we have to understand is if pastor's kids, and hear me out first, because if you're like, I'm not a pastor's kid, so he's not even talking to me right now. No, hear me out first. If pastor's kids can understand to not run away from their calling or run away from the DNA that God's put in your family, you would see that there are potential leaders for the next generation, and you could answer that call. Now, what if you're not a pastor's kid? Here's the thing about it, though. If you're not a pastor's kid, I understand on the opposite side, because my wife beforehand, she was not a pastor's kid, and I saw in her life some of the difficulties that she had becoming a spirit-filled Christian when her parents were very traditional. See, for this generation, for us, tradition isn't really in our vocabulary. It's not. For instance, maybe some of your parents are like, Pastor Sam, he wears jeans to church? That's not Sunday best at all. Right? Sometimes they wear sneakers to church. Tennis shoes on a Sunday? No. Sometimes I wear a hat to church. The Lord's not going to hear him. He wore a hat. Right? I've heard all these things. But I want to be honest with you about something. I think that tradition has stopped a lot of pastor kids or a lot of kids who have grown up in church to see a future in being a leader for God. Now, I think that's something that God wants to break you free from is tradition or religion, and what he wants to bring you into is just a true relationship with him. That's all that he asked for anyways. It's funny because I think about where I am now in life and where I was when I was y'all's age. When I was y'all's age, there's a big age gap in the room at the moment, though. But when I was high school, right? High school or even middle school, I had one thing in mind. Girls. That was it. Hear me out, boys. I went to all the summer camps. You know why? Yeah. Fun games. Y'all are messed up in the mind. You know that? All y'all that are thinking girls. But I did go to camps because there was a lot of girls there. Guess what happened? I stopped myself at a young age from being able to understand my calling or understand what God wanted me to do, because every time I had an opportunity to get close with God, I allowed my flesh to overcome what it was that my spirit needed. And I went to summer camps and I told myself, oh, I'm gonna have a great time. It's gonna be fun and all these kind of things. And you know, the enemy knows what it is that you like to pull you away from God, right? So the enemy dangles what it is that you really enjoy in front of you, and instead of focusing on God at the altar or focusing on God at conferences, you're trying to get that person's number. All right, fine, Pastor Sam. I'm not worried about relationships right now. That's not me. Okay, cool. So then popularity at school, right? So then identity at school, right? Being able to fit in with people. That's the hardest thing for many of us, right? And I experienced that, right? In middle school and high school, I didn't have that problem. I felt like in middle school and high school, I was kind of not on the popular side, but I was well known because I didn't hang out with Asian people in middle school or high school. I just refused. I despised it. They played tennis, I played football. They played tennis, I played basketball. They played, you know, just
they were in debate. I was definitely not in debate. They were in like host on stuff. Nah, not me, right? So that wasn't me at all. And so I didn't fit into the mold that I guess, honestly, that the world would think. And so as I grew up in high school and middle school, I really had a lot of friends only because I knew and I was comfortable with who I was in middle school and high school. I knew it. I was like, you don't like me? It's all right. Someone else will. You don't want to talk to me? It's okay. Somebody else will. That was my mentality in middle school and high school. I couldn't be fazed at all. Didn't bother me. I didn't care because I was like, it's all right. If you don't like me, so cool. I'll find someone else. I'm good. Until college came. Because in middle school, I grew up with these people for 3 years. In high school, I then went to school with other people, or with the same people for 4 years, or new people that knew of me from other schools. So I didn't have a problem fitting in. I didn't have a problem trying to figure things out, right? Come college, I was nobody in a school of thousands of people. So in college, what ended up happening was I started to compromise who I was just to fit in with the world. I started to change the way I dressed just because the fraternity guys dressed a certain way. Oh, I started to talk differently just because the fraternity guys talked a different way. I tried to do certain things so that I would be seen by the fraternity guys. And it worked. It worked. It's not that hard to copy the world, guys. It's easy. You want to be popular? Just do one TikTok trend. You want to be popular? Buy whatever the influencers are talking about. It works. Look at half of you guys wearing Air Force Ones or New Balances. God, no, I'm just kidding. Now everybody's wearing Dunks, right? So it's too easy to be manipulated by the world. Shout out to everybody wearing Pandas. Just kidding. Oh, right? So something that you have to really see is it's too easy to get sucked in or fit in with the world. It's easy. It doesn't take much work at all. How do you fit in the world? If you're feeling like you can't fit in, I'll tell you how. A little bit of money. Just buy a little bit. You know what you need to buy? Guess what? Winter time's coming, right? Buy some Uggs. You'll fit in, right? We're in Texas, yet we still wear Uggs. Just fit in somehow, right? Birkenstocks, just fit in, right? You just buy those things. It's money that you can buy fame. It's money that you can buy things to fit in. That's it. That's all that you need. At the cost of wanting to be accepted by people, all it takes is just buying whatever is the trend. That's it. That's it. That's all that you have to do. And so in college, that's what I did. I bought the latest things. I'm going to sound really old, but back then, Roshis were a thing. You're like, what are Roshis, Pastor Sam? Those are the shoes that are now on clearance at the clearance store, on clearance. But they were the most comfortable shoes back then. I bought a good amount of them. Those were the gifts that I wanted at the time. And then even bringing it back even more, the really, really, really popular backpacks are now at like Ross and Marshall's, were like Herschel backpacks. Those were the thing back then. Now they're like $15 at Marshall's or Ross. This is embarrassing. But that was it. You had to just buy those things, and people were like, dude. And that's all you needed to do to fit in. Now, in the world that we live in today, you don't really have to buy things to fit in, but it's really about staying true to who you are to fit in. It's a little bit different in the world. But the problem is, I think that there are too many people who shy away from talking about God in their individuality right now in the world, because that's what's popular. Nobody wants to be a carbon copy of anybody anymore. You're who you are, and if you stand for who you are, that's actually what attracts people to you. But I don't think that there's enough people in the world who are really standing out for God. I don't think that there are enough people who are talking about how important God is in their life. You know how I know? Is because you would not tell anyone about this conference that you went to and your life got changed. You'll tell them, I went to Houston. Yeah, I did something cool. What'd you do? I met with some people and we went to eat. But you won't talk about conference or how God affected your life. You're ashamed of God. You know that camp that a lot of y'all went to? Unashamed. You know what I'm talking about? All right, well, most of y'all realistically are actually ashamed of God. So you can say it unashamed, but when you're actually put in a place where you have to talk about God, are you truly unashamed or are you ashamed? As a pastor, the Lord put me in check. The Lord's moving in a way in our church where he's been using me in a way to hear from the Holy Spirit clearly, hear the Holy Spirit's voice clearly, and I'm talking about spot on clear. I'm talking about he's allowed me to hear from him, and it's like spot on about your life. Don't get scared now. He's gonna tell me stuff about you. You have pandas. No, I'm just kidding. What he's gonna tell me is things that only you would know that I wouldn't know, and if I said that in your life, you would say that could only be God. So the Lord's been doing something incredible with my life that I didn't think he was going to do until I got to the point where I said, Lord, I'm truly not ashamed of you. I want to be used by you, even if I have to speak to the older generation that doesn't want to hear from me. I'll still talk about you. For probably, I would say, Tuan, what's the count? You posted it the other day. 32 days? 33 days? 33 days. 33 days, right? Since, I think it was like the last week, last Sunday of August or something like that. We've literally been coming to church every single day to pray and worship God. Every day. It started out with 21 days of prayer. And for many of y'all's churches, y'all fast and pray. Y'all usually do that. But the Lord put it in my heart, and the Holy Spirit spoke to my life and said, do you really want to see an increase in your life? Do you really want to see a change in your church? And during that time, that's when the word of prophecy came out about the Lord being able to bring revival to Houston through the Vietnamese people, right? That's what was said. And I just felt like this. I felt like, well, Lord, I've seen you do incredible things in my dad's life and in the 40 years he's done ministry, but I have yet to see that kind of revival and that kind of fire in the generation that I'm in right now. So I want to say yes to that. And I want to say, Lord, use me to bring revival. And then I said those words, like I said to you guys, I said those words with my mouth. And the Lord said, all right, you sure about that? And Pastor Khan's message, my dad preaching message was, Lord, send me, right? We're talking about courageous prayers or bold prayers for that entire month. One of them happened to be, Lord, break my heart for what breaks your heart. The other one happened to be, you know, Lord, send me. And one of the biggest things that changed in my life during that time, and I'm not even joking with you, was the difference between blowing smoke or actually doing something about the words that you said. And many of us in church, you'll say whatever you want to say during that time, but when it truly comes down to trusting in God, you revert back to your old ways. I was exactly like that. I can only say this in a holy, convicting way. Because it convicted my heart personally. And it wasn't through, oh, you're bad, or oh, you're sinning. No, it wasn't anything like that. It was more along the lines of, you said what you were gonna do, but you're not doing it. How many of you have done this before? You left a powerful experience at a camp. You left a powerful experience at a conference. Lord, I promise you, I'm gonna read the Bible. You come back home on Monday. Nothing yet. Okay, on Tuesday, I'm going to read a little bit more of my Bible. It's ready the next month by then. And then you're like, you know what, Lord? I'll just wait till the next camp and I'll be on fire with you. That's not bad. I'll just give you a little bit of me on Sundays, right? Because I sing on the praise team or I play drums or I do this or I do that. But I'm not going to give you everything of me, just Sundays only. And maybe on youth nights. But to truly give everything of me, Lord, not yet. I'm not ready for that. And so when I was saying these kind of words, hear me out, it might not have sounded exactly like that because of where I am in life, but it was more along the lines of this, Lord, I'll step up and I'll help take over the church with Dad. I'll help take over all the English services. And I said that about a year ago, maybe a little bit longer. And the Lord put it in my heart, remember when you said you were going to help Dad take over the English services? Why is he preaching more than you in English service then? You know, I got a baby, Lord. Never mind. I'm sorry. Lord, I promise you, Lord, I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. I'm going to do this. We say things with our words, but we never really put action behind it. And when it comes to the things of the Lord, because something that I've learned in this experience as the Lord's been using me, he's used me to lead the church in times of prayer and fasting, but also to be in his presence. I've seen things change in parents that they're the prayers of the students. I've seen parents literally fall in love with each other by just being in God's presence. I'm serious. Nobody wants to talk about it. There's not that many Vietnamese parents in the room, but let's be real. Some of y'all grow up in households where your parents are married, but they sleep in two separate rooms. Gong, it's because Dad snores. No, it's not. Let's be real. Nobody wants to talk about it, right? Service is being streamed, so I'm being as honest as I can be. Because if I can be honest with what I know that many of us experience, then we can start praying for those things. Nobody really wants to talk about what life is like outside of church because everybody pretends what life is like in church. You know what I've seen? I've seen fathers come to the altar crying because they need repentance because of how they treat their kids, because they need healing from their fathers not being there for them. And for many of us in this generation, you're like, I hate my dad. My dad doesn't understand. My dad doesn't talk to me. All he tells me to do is go cut the grass, go take the trash out, go get a job and all these kind of things. He doesn't love me. He just wants me to do stuff. Nah, here's the thing though. Maybe he was never loved in his life, so he doesn't know how to show love to you. And so when I saw fathers break down here at the altar by receiving forgiveness and by receiving healing from God, and then telling the Lord that they're going to go show their kids that love, that's the kind of change that I'm talking about. That's the kind of don't just blow smoke and do something about it. I've actually seen fathers hug their sons at the altar and cry. There's a dad that I know. I call him Boss. I used to work for him when I was in like middle school. He's one of the nicest, loving people that I know, but sometimes the way he just looks at you, you'd get scared. And he's never, ever, ever shown me anything besides loving on me, loving on the church, loving on God, loving on my family. And Lord, it just broke my heart when I saw him here at the altar crying. He was crying out to the Lord during that time of asking for forgiveness and asking the Lord to heal his heart. I had to ask my dad. I said, I've known him all my life. Do you know the relationship he had with his dad? And he was like, actually, his stepdad. There was an accident when he was growing up, and there was an explosion that happened. His skin was burnt. The only things that were left were skin on his feet. And the stepdad said, leave him, he's gonna die. And they walked out on him. Yeah. Then I saw him come to the altar, ask the Lord to heal his heart. And after that, I saw him hug his son at the altar. Maybe he doesn't hug his son like that, but he did that day. The Lord's doing something. The Lord's doing a change. If you're honest and if you're serious and if you really want to be about him. But if you're playing games, if you're playing church games, and this is where I have to be honest with you, you can play church games all you want. All you want. It does you no good. There's something that I saw in scripture that I really want to share with you guys, is that I personally feel that your relationship with God can get even further. You can have breakthrough. And it's actually something that Jesus says in the Bible. He says that he has to go so the Holy Spirit can come, because it's better for him to go and better for the Holy Spirit to be here. He's an advocate. He's going to help us. He's going to help the disciples at the time. You know how crazy it is that, for me, I didn't really know this, right? My dad got filled with the Holy Spirit and the time that the church was really moving in the presence of God, I was like 4 years old. So ever since then, I've only known that growing up. But I know that some people have gone to traditional churches, and if you hear anything about the Holy Spirit, they're like, witchcraft. That's crazy. No, no way. There's no way. No, that's not real. That's not from God. Falling out? Are you kidding me? The pastor's pushing them down. He's putting stuff on his hands, this oil to like put over their nose. So they just like, what is this, like a Marvel movie? Like, what do they think that we're doing? Like, shh, go to sleep. Like what? These are the things that people are saying. Am I going to get ridiculed for it? Probably. Somebody's going to watch this and be like, that pastor in Houston, Muxikansan, I knew it. I knew they did witchcraft stuff. Now my kids are coming home. They want to believe in this Holy Spirit. Here's a crazy thing. I've asked the Lord, what is it that I'm supposed to be reading in the Bible to be able to understand what he's doing in our church more? I've only been able to read in the book of Acts. I can't read in anything else. I've only been able to read in the book of Acts. I've read the book of Acts many times, but this is the only assignment I have from God. In the book of Acts, highlight every time that the Holy Spirit's spoken about. That's all I've been doing. And you see where it says the disciples were filled with the Holy Spirit, and then I highlight it. Or you see other places where it says so-and-so was filled with the Spirit, so I highlight that. And other places it says that people recognize the power and the authority because they were filled with the Spirit. And I highlight those. Okay. Here's the problem, though. I said this to my dad. I said, Dad, how come a lot of people that are very traditional, they'll read about the Bible, they can quote scripture back and forth, they even challenge me sometimes about scripture and all these things, but when it comes to scripture in the book of Acts, and it says so many times about the Holy Spirit, and even more in the New Testament, why do they think that it's not real, or why do they think it's just Bible times? Okay, hear me out though. You're a Christian, so you can accept that Jesus died on the cross. But wait, isn't that Bible time? So we pick and choose what we want to believe in God based off of our human nature, of what we accept from God. You don't think deliverance is real? Oh, that's just like exorcism. No, it's real. It's real. I've seen people be delivered. Oh, Pastor John, that's crazy talk. No, I'm not about that. I'm not about that. Here's the thing, though. Every single day, I hope you know that there's a battle of good and evil. And we know that. It's easy to see in our world. There is a battle of good and evil. Something that the Holy Spirit does for us is to remind us of the promises of God, remind us of the things that Jesus has taught us in the Bible, remind us of the things that God has literally created us for. But many of us don't have that kind of relationship with the Holy Spirit. Do you know what relationship we actually have? We just have a relationship with God based off of the relationship of our pastor's relationship with God. And for many of us, when you ask the question, like, where do you read in the Bible? You're like, I don't know until Sunday. I'm a pastor's kid. I'll share you the truth. That was me. I'm being honest. You know, something that people say is like, Pastor Sam, he's pastor honest. I can't lie about these things. If I lied, I'd just be another statistic in the world that pastors' kids are terrible and blah, blah, blah. Leave church, all these kind of things. I don't want to be a part of that. I don't want to compromise who I am just to get temporary satisfaction in the world. I can't do that. I've lived that life. It doesn't last that long. People accept you, then they hate you. Temporary satisfaction, but knowing who the Lord has created me to be and knowing what he's done in my life, I don't think I'll ever sell this. All right, Romans chapter 8, I'll read it really quick for you guys. Romans chapter 8, verses 26 down, and you guys can just listen, or if you want to write it down, maybe it's something that you might want to read later. I'm reading out of the NLT version. Romans 8, 26 down, it says, and the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. For example, we don't know what God wants us to pray for, but the Holy Spirit prays for us with groanings that cannot be expressed in words. And the Father who knows all hearts knows what the Spirit is saying, for the Spirit pleads for us believers in harmony with God's own will. And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them. For God knew his people in advance, and he chose them to become like his son so that his son would be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And having chosen them, he called them to come to him, and having called them, he gave them right standing with himself, and having given them right standing, he gave them his glory. This scripture, I was asking the Lord, because remember, this isn't in the book of Acts. This is in Romans, right after. I was like, Lord, what am I supposed to speak to the youth about? And here's the thing. This is something that I wanted to share with you guys, because the importance of having a relationship with the Holy Spirit is going to help many of you in the things that you're dealing with. In the very first portion of it, it says, and the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. There are times in your life that's tough, and I won't be the first one to say that life's easy. It's rough. One experience, one encounter, many of you guys know this. My wife and I, we prayed for a son or a baby for years. And then 3 years, we dealt with infertility, couldn't have a baby. I personally almost gave up on really believing that God would do a miracle in my life. As a pastor, hear me out. You know how crazy it was? I was praying for a baby, really declaring that God would bring a baby in my life. I couldn't have a baby, but my siblings were popping babies. What? It was hard. I loved on them. I love every nephew and niece. But I was like, Lord, when am I going to be able to have a baby? It's not easy. I'll be honest with you. Life's not easy. But it's not about that. It's about the trust in God that you can have in the valleys, not just at the mountaintops. And I really had to ask the Holy Spirit to really speak into my life and help me to stay focused and trust in the Lord. I had to. I couldn't give up. After 3 years of praying, after really trusting in the Lord, I got the miracle. Easton, he's sitting over there drinking a bottle right now or sleeping. It's not easy during the tough times to trust in the Lord, but it says, and the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. Do you know how many days and hours and long nights that I asked the Holy Spirit to bring comfort to me? It wasn't easy, guys. That's a perspective that I hope that other pastors could share, but they don't share it. The perspective of how realistic it is to pray for people, for them to have kids, and they have kids, but you're praying that in your heart and it doesn't happen. Or the perspective of praying for somebody for something and it happens for them, but not you. And you're like, Lord, when is it my time? You know what the Lord revealed to me during that? He said, well, when are you going to actually put me first before your feelings? I want it on my time, Lord. I want it now. If I don't have it now, it's going to be tough. If I don't have what I want now, Lord, I don't know what I'm going to do in life. I need this job right now. I really need it. I really need to get into this exact school. I really need this. I really need that. But we want it all on our timing, but not on God's timing. You know what the Holy Spirit has helped me? Holy Spirit has helped me and reminded me of the things that God has promised for me. He does have a plan and purpose for my life. According to his plan, according to his purpose for my life, and his timing. You know what happens whenever you allow God to be first and you second? You now have to play or live, follow the leader. And following the leader means following after what God wants us to do. It's one of the hardest things that we can do. Why? Because we want to do whatever it is that we want to do. And personally right now, I just feel like the Holy Spirit wants me to really just speak from the heart and be honest with you guys. Is that in this room right now, for many of y'all, y'all struggle. You go to church, but you're just going to Sunday school. You're just showing up. Either you're a pastor's kid or your friend invited you or your parents are a part of leadership and then that's why you have to go. But honestly, realistically, you could care less about going to church. For many of you, the relationship that you want to have with God, you lost it a long time ago. But to be on fire for God, to want to be on fire for God, comes from your own heart. It comes from the cry of your heart. It comes from the cry of you understanding that you need God more than anything else in life. You know, and then there's other people in the room. You're saying, no, Pastor Sam, that ain't me at all. I'm on fire for God. I'm a youth leader. I'm this. I'm on the worship team. I take photos. I take videos. I do church IG. I do all this kind of, okay, that's great. That's amazing. That's awesome. But don't ever get satisfied with where your relationship with God is. You should always want more of him. You should always understand we could sacrifice more for him. You should always understand that you can help build the kingdom even more. I think for many of us, we were on fire for God. We did things for the Lord, and we hit the coast button. Ah, yeah, I brought a friend to church right after camp. It was awesome. I told him about my testimony. It was great. Come next year, you just remind yourself you've only brought one person to church. See, for me personally, something that the Lord has showed me is I can't live off of past experiences from him. I can't live off of past glory. No, I need to experience him daily. I've got to experience his, and I got to have an encounter with his presence daily. That only comes from having a relationship with him. Only comes from allowing the Holy Spirit to be a part of your life, to speak in your life every day. How is the Holy Spirit going to move in this room? How is the Lord going to change your life or change your heart? It's only by the hunger that you want. I can hunger all I want for you guys to really be on fire for the Lord, really have a relationship with God. And guess what? It's all hopes and dreams. But for you guys, it's something that you have to make a decision for yourself. I can't force you into a relationship with God. I'll give you an example. How many of you have been in children's ministry before? Parents come running over. I need to check out my kid. Gone. Come on, let's go. We have to go to the altar to pray. And they bring you up. You're a little kid. And there's a pastor praying. And you're like. And then the pastor lays their hands on you. You're like 8 years old. You don't even know what's going on. So you just do this. And then you go, amen. And then you run off. You know how many times that's happened? Some of you guys that have grown up coming to conference, I've seen that so many times. So many times. Parents run over there. I need to check out my kid right now. Right now? Right now. They check you out. You run over here. You really need prayer, Gong. Okay? They bring you to the altar. You don't even want it for yourself because you don't even know what they're doing right now. You get up there. So now at the age that you're at and asking you guys, to want to experience with God, to have experience with God, or to want to experience God on your own, it's on you now. There's no mom or dad coming here to be like, oh, come on, let's go to the altar. It's just you. That's it. I had to learn that in the last month. That at home, when I'm by myself, and I'm speaking with God, speaking with the Holy Spirit, is the cry of my heart to lead the church? Is the cry of my heart to have more of God? Or is the cry of my heart, man, I just wish the youth could just get it together. Oh, I just wish the church would just understand. No, that's not the cry of my heart. The cry of my heart is this, is Lord, I just want the church to encounter your presence. Use me, Lord, however you want. I'll say yes. I'll share two things and then we'll end. The first thing is this, something that the Lord has done in my life for me to be able to experience him the way that I have is this. I've had to tell the Lord, because I had to understand this, Lord, I'm nothing without you. I'm nobody without you. Nobody. And the conversation I had with the Lord that helped me really change the way that I thought was during the time of 21 days of prayer and fasting, we were coming to the church. I was at home, and I was thinking about what the Lord's been doing. And then I thought about who I was. I was getting ready for church, ready to lead the people. And the Lord's been using me for about a week during that time, first week of 21 days. I just sat in my restroom looking at the mirror. I said, Lord, who am I compared to Pastor Khan? Who am I compared to Chuck Pierce? Who am I compared to Joshua Giles? Who am I compared to Doug Stringer? I'm nobody compared to them. Of course, Muksubung and other pastors that are leading the morning sessions. Who am I compared to them? I'm nobody. I'm at the bottom of the totem pole, Lord. Why would anybody want to listen to me? Why would anybody want to use me? Why would anybody want me to speak in their church? Just because I'm young and I'm the only young like pastor right now that people know of that is in the Vietnamese community from like the spirit-filled side. I said all these things in my head. I was crying out to God. And the Lord said to me, just as clear as day, through the Holy Spirit was like, if you continue to do the things that I ask you to do, if you continue to say yes, your fame won't come from the things that you're doing on your own, but you'll be known from my kingdom for the things that you say yes to. I bawled my eyes out. Because guess what? In that moment, I saw something. My flesh was surfacing again. That college Sam was surfacing again. I just want to be accepted by people. I just want to be accepted by other church leaders. I just want to be accepted by other. That's what was surfacing. I kid you not, 1 week later. It was, y'all remember on social media where the parents were like, it's Daughter's Day, let's post about our daughters. It's Sunday, let's post about our son. Okay, you're like, no, we don't get on Facebook passion. All right, I'm sorry. But yes, that's what your parents were doing, so you have embarrassing photos of yourself on Facebook right now. But my dad, during the 21 days of prayer and fasting, the second week, I remember him. He was standing right here, and he was looking up at the stage. And then he kind of, like, does something. And I'm playing guitar leading, and I'm like, what is he doing? He turns around and goes, and he talks to my mom. And then I'm like, what is he doing? And then, like, he looks around. And he, like, walks around the church. And I'm like, what is he doing? I'm up there like, Jesus. And I'm like, what are you doing? And then he's like, and he sees my sister. I'm like, what is happening right now? I'm like playing guitar. He's like, I read lips really well. He's like, where's Mike? And I was like, what? Why are they asking about Mike right now? Like, what's going on? Like, what's happening? Like, somebody's outside of the church. Like, what's happening? I said, where's Mike? And then Mike's like in a different room. Mike comes in because they find him. And then my dad, he stops the service and comes up to the front. And he says, the Lord has put something in my heart. If you look up at the stage right now, in that moment, and Thong was there, I asked him to come and be a part of it. He said, in that moment right there, we have four different pastors' sons in the room or worshiping God in that moment. It was myself, someone named Vinang that's a part of our church, and Thong, and Mike was there. Then my dad saw Wook and other people that were in the house that were pastors' kids. And my dad said, today the world is doing something where they're honoring sons and things like that. And he said, I feel like the Holy Spirit's putting something in my heart, church, and I want you guys to hear me out. And that day, I didn't ever expect this to happen. Ever. My dad stood there. He brought all the sons in the front of all the pastors, stood them up in the front, and he looks at me and he says, Sam, Pastor Sam, I'm sorry that people in the church don't honor the fact that you said yes to the Lord and that you're a pastor. And he said that he felt the Lord wanting the church to see that for the last X amount of days that I was up there leading the church, I was being led by the Holy Spirit, that the Lord was using me to lead his people closer to him. It took a weight off of my shoulders because for, I think, 8 years now, at a revival conference. I was ordained to be a pastor. And on that day, as I was getting ordained, I watched people scoff and walk out. Just because he's Pastor Khan's son. I could do a better job than him. Yeah, right. I'm not going to listen to that dude. Sunday at church. Gong, I used to take care of you so you didn't call. You were so, yeah. But they didn't want to listen to anything that I had to say when it came to leading about God. Gong, what do you know? I've been in church longer than you. I used to change your diapers. Oh, and then, you know, what's worse is whenever I didn't hear the words, but I could just see it through their actions, right? Pastor Sam's preaching. We're out. I dealt with that for years. And in that time, I thought, this ain't going to hurt me. Remember high school, middle school, Sam? They don't accept me. Some other people will. It's all good. Yeah, it actually really affected me. Because I carried something on my life that made me think that I was never good enough to be used by God in the way that my dad was. And in that day, my dad broke something off of my life. And on that day, it changed in the church. It changed. You know, some parents, including some of y'all's parents, I'll see them at conference. Gong, I want you to meet my kid. Okay? Like, they need to know about God. Okay? From you. Me? You know, my response is, what about you? No, you, Gong, the Lord's going to use you. And I'm like, okay. And then it's almost like a label that I guess people have kind of put on my life that I'm only good enough to teach their kids, but not them. The only allow the Lord to use me to speak to their kids, but not them. Because what does a young kid know more than someone who's been alive longer and been in church longer? Oh, it hurts so bad. I know, Gong. It hurts so bad. And you know something that really changed is when it broke in the room, my dad said those things. And then people, the Vietnamese adults in the building, they just came up to me and they're like, Pastor Sam, we honor you and we thank you and we trust your leading and your guiding. Randomly, people would start saying that to me. And then on a Sunday, someone who I haven't even seen at the 21 days, they live in College Station. They came up to me, they're like, Muksu, I want you to know something. I was like, yeah, I'll never say anything bad about you. I am behind you in your leadership. I trust you. I was like, oh, thanks, where's this coming from? I was like, Dad, why did they say that? He's like, oh, he's been watching the entire time. And then other people were saying these things. And then something that broke my heart, it was somebody that used to be at the church whenever I was like a baby or younger. And he came back to the church recently after years. And he said, Sam, I love you so much, Gong. So when you were younger, I held you. And I remember walking around the church with you. I love you, Sam. And he said, but to see where you're at now in life, I respect the calling that God has on your life. Even though I knew you when you're a baby, but God's using you in a way that's really blessed my life. And I was like, what? And I remember back at the conversation that the Lord had with me. If you just say yes to me, I'll elevate you, and people will know you because of the things you've done for me, not because of the things you've done for the world. And it changed my life. Then I started to have parents come up to me and like, Muksu, you know, they started saying things that, man, it's awesome. I have some parents that come up to me, Muksu, we come into church the next day? I say, yeah, all right, we're going to be there with you. So, okay, cool. I had someone say this, after 21 days, Muksu, what are we going to do? I said, honestly, I feel like the Lord's still calling me to do this. I probably would be up here by myself. Like, I feel that calling in my heart. And it was Christina and Jonathan's dad. He said, well, you better not miss a day because I'm going to be up here every day with you. I said, you're the man. And I've had parents come up to me and they've told me how the Lord has used me to impact their life. Now, hear me out. I didn't spend this moment to be like, fluff up yourself. No, I didn't. What I'm trying to share with you is this, is even though you're young, God can still use you to impact even your church, and even the adults will see it. And even the adults could be impacted by it. Why? Because it's not you doing it, but it's God doing it through you. And something that you have to see or have to understand is all that God needs is your yes. If you can just say, yes, Lord, I'll be used by you. And yes, Lord, I will be unashamed. And I'll talk, even if you put it in my heart, Lord, I'll be unashamed. And I will say something for you if this is truly from you. And that's why it's so important to have a relationship with the Holy Spirit, because you don't want to come up to some adult and be like, the Lord said, and it's not really the Lord. The Lord said it was wrong for you to tell me that I wouldn't hear from the Lord because I wore a hat that day. Yeah. You gotta truly hear from the Lord, because that's not the kind of things that the Lord's been putting in my heart. The Lord's been putting things on my heart that I never thought I would say to an adult, but the moment I said it to them, they broke down and they cried because they're like, how did you know? Only the Lord. Only the Holy Spirit. See, what the Lord revealed to me is, it's not about your wisdom or your age and how long you've been in ministry, but it's the things that I'll tell you. If you say yes and you say it to them, then they'll know that you're being used by me. And for many of you in the room, I hope that you can take this message and run with it, because your life can change. Or you can keep playing church games. See, I'm a little different when it comes to preaching. Yes, I'm a little pushy when it comes to that point, and when it comes to making that call for the Lord, because the reason why I'm a little bit pushy is because I believe that I've grown up in church for so long that I remember what it was like to be in one of y'all's seats. Go to a camp, leave the camp, not on fire for God. Go to a camp, on fire for God, fizzles out next week. Go to a camp, pastor tells you to keep up with the friend group, don't even text them anymore. Yeah. That's why I'm a little bit pushy for this next generation, because I think that this is what happens to the young generation. We go to church, and most of it's about the Vietnamese adults. And for us, it's either you're put in a small classroom, fend for yourself kind of thing. It's kind of tough. Typically what happens is the pastor that's in charge of the youth program is a pastor that's like up and coming in the church. So like, hey, test out it with the youth. And like, I think God's done something different in my life, where when I first started, the calling on my life was really for the youth. Because I really wanted to help people understand. And like, God's been putting on my heart like to have a conference just for like pastors' kids, to really help you guys understand that you don't have to run away from your calling, that you can actually serve God and love God, even though you might have had hurt from what you saw with your parents. And the very last thing I'll share with you, and then I'm gonna open up this time for the altar, is this, is God doesn't need you to have skills and talents. God just needs you to say yes, and he'll elevate every skill and talent you need. I promise you. I'm not the best at drums. I won't claim to be the best at drums. I won't claim to be the best at guitar or singing or anything. But I will say this, though. I don't know music theory. I don't know how to play crazy beats. I might not be as good as drum. I might not be as good as any other guitar player or singer, but I will say this, I know how to worship. And that's all I know how to do. I know how to worship, and that's it. That's all that matters to me, is I know how to worship God with all of my heart. And that's all that he asks for. And he elevates me. I had someone come up to me yesterday. I really didn't think that they were gonna say this to me. And they're like, Moksu, that time of worship, it was powerful. You're a powerful worship leader. I was like, thanks. It's like, wow, thank you. But what difference was it from what I did and what other people do? But it's really helping people come close to his presence. See, the call today for being filled with the Spirit, allowing the Holy Spirit to move in your life, allowing the Holy Spirit to cleanse your life, isn't so that you only have a strong relationship with God. It's so that you have a strong relationship with God, so that you can bring others closer to God. That's the point. What good is it to have a better relationship with God elevated after conference if you go and then only keep it for yourself? What good is that? That does no good, actually. Someone told me something during the 21 days. I was so confused for a second. I said, Pastor Sam, I had a vision. I said, yeah, tell me. I saw on the pulpit, there was a fat man there. I was like, bruh, like. He was like, you know, and he's one of those guys who's very blunt, right, and very honest. I was like, all right, carry on. He just paused. I was like, bro, come on. He's like, no, like the church, representation of the church. The church is just full of people who are just fat in the spirit, but they have never worked it out. They get all they can from God, but they never utilize it out in the world. So they can quote scriptures. They can sing worship songs. But how many people have they told about the kingdom or about his goodness or about his grace or about his forgiveness or about the second chance that they can have with the Lord? They know everything in their heart. They'll lead a Bible study. They're good on bass, drums, guitar, singing, and all those kind of things. Filled with his spirit. But when it comes to talking about him outside of the church, that's a little different. And that's where things should change. For many of us in this room, God can use you to change the school that you're at. God can use you to change the job that you're at. In the 21 days, there was this lady. She just started coming to our church. And she says that she has a small business, and the business is doing lashes, right? And she was like, man, the Lord's been just moving in my heart. And she shared this testimony. And she said, when my clients come in, I tell them, I have a good relationship with the Lord. And if the Lord's telling me something about you, I'm going to just tell you. Like it or not, I'm going to just tell you. And they're like, yeah, okay. And for the ladies that get your lashes done, you know, you're screwed once you lay down on that table. You're just stuck. You just have to look up and you can try to sleep or whatever, but you're stuck. And so she says, when the Holy Spirit puts stuff in her heart, she tells them. They're just laying there like, okay. And you know what she says? She was worried that she would lose clients. But then at the end, they're like, how did you know that? God really told you that about my life? That's so spot on. And she was like, it's just the Lord. And she brings them closer to the Lord. And then she says they come back to her store and they look at her like, you hear anything else from the Lord about me? And she goes, did you pray? And they're like, no. They're like, then why would you hear something from the Lord? And she has this like boldness now. And she's like in our church. And I'm like, wow. I want that kind of faith, Lord. And then another lady was like, man, Pastor Sam, the Lord's been doing something amazing in my life. I was like, yeah, tell me. She was like, there's this older lady at the gym. And I saw that she was injured. So I put the Holy Spirit put in my heart, go pray for her. And at first I was like, ah. And then I was like, you know what? Have that faith. And she went over and prayed for them. The random lady in the gym, right? She goes and prays for them. And then she was like, it says amen and whatever, and she leaves. The next day she goes to the gym, and the old lady is there. Older lady is there. And the older lady was like telling her, hey, come here. I'm healed. And she was like, praise God. Wow, amazing. In the gym. Dude, God's doing something. I want to hear stories from the youth, from the younger generation. If the Lord is doing something in the older generation, he can surely do things in the younger generation. It's all about sacrifice. So this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to have, Thong, you want to play a piano for me? You can just play Worthy again. Is that cool? I want to offer up this time for you guys. If the message, if you're feeling God like, tugging on your heart, or you're really feeling the Lord moving in your life right now, and you're like, man, everything this guy's saying, that's really what I'm feeling. That's what I don't want to be like that. I want to be different. I want to be on fire for God, and I want to keep that fire. I feel like the Lord's going to change your life based off of the hunger that you bring to him right now. This is how I'm going to do service. 3:37, I'll close service. That way, for those who be like, hey, it's not my time right now, Pastor Sam, I'll get there one day, but not right now, it's okay, in your own timing. Like I said, I'm not going to be like your mom and dad, be like, come on, come to the altar. Look, Sue's trying to pray for you. Nah, just in your own timing. So I want to pray, close out service. Those that want to stay, I'm going to stay and pray for you guys, and the Lord's going to work in your life. But don't feel obligated to stay. Go and enjoy and have fun out there and talk with friends, mingle, make friends. But I do ask this, if you're still in the room, just keep it down so that people can, and respect the time that people have up here at the altar, okay? So, Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for just the word that you gave today and just out of Romans, Lord, just to understand that having the Holy Spirit, it really is a good thing. And having the Holy Spirit in our life was a gift from you, and that the Holy Spirit helps us during times of need. And he reminds us of things that you've talked to us and taught us about. And Lord, we thank you. And we ask right now, Lord, that you be with us, Lord, and that you help us to have this hunger for you. And Lord, we thank you for what you're going to do in this place, Lord. And we thank you, Lord, and we also ask, Lord, that you increase in our life even more. I have to stop my prayer because I just even heard from the Holy Spirit. I'm sorry. You know how I said I wanted to close service early and then you can go if you wanted to go or whatever, and I just heard from the Holy Spirit, are you really that ashamed of me that you would allow people to leave without really encountering my presence? So let me change my prayer. Lord, I ask that you impact all the hearts in the room. Lord, I ask that you bring just a hunger in everybody that's sitting in this room. That for those who have been struggling to have a true relationship with you, Lord, I ask that you bring them to a place of repentance, bring them to a place of yearning to want or to need more of you in their life. Lord, I ask for just an increase of your presence right now. Right now, Lord. For those of you who this message has hit you or you're saying, I feel the Lord really tugging on my heart, the altar's open, come to the altar, come to the front, allow the Lord to use you. And these are the kind of things that you'll be saying when you're up here is, Lord, forgive me for the games that I've been playing, for the church game that I've been playing. Lord, fill me up even more. Allow all of the mess in my life to be flushed out, and I just want more of your presence. If the Lord's speaking to your heart, come to the altar. Come to the altar. Don't hesitate. Don't wait. If you want more of God, have that hunger. Just a time of just praying and speaking to the Lord. As those that are up here praying, that prayer for you is, Lord, I want more of you. I don't want to do life without you. I don't want to try to pretend anymore. I don't want to try to do these things anymore without your presence. I want more of you. I want more of you, God. Look, if you're sitting in your seat right now and you're just like, I'm just not sure, I'll just say it as easy as I can is, why not give it a shot? Or why not take a leap of faith? That's all that God asks anyways. What harm could it do to say yes? Allow God to just impact your heart. Allow God to just impact your life in a way that maybe you've never experienced before. No reason to have fear about it. No reason to hesitate to want more of God. That shouldn't be a reason. The only reason I feel like other people would be sitting in chairs and not wanting more of God is that maybe you've been offended by the church. Or maybe you've been offended by people. Or maybe you've been offended by, I used to go to church or I still go to church, but the thing about it is I was hurt by the church and any of those things. Man, just let God set you free from that. Let God set you free from that. For many of you in this room, the other portion of it would be, but this is new to me. Okay, it's kind of weird. Like, I'm just going to be honest with you, Pastor. Like, I'm not trying to fall. Well, here's the thing. It's not guaranteed that you're going to fall. It's not. Some of you might come up here and the Lord might touch your life and you might just cry. For me, when the Lord touches me, I have the ugliest cry ever. There's photos of me everywhere with the ugly cry, but I don't care. It's for the Lord. It's not about what you're going to have or not have. It's not about falling, or it's not about, oh, people are going to start, if he prays for me, like, I might speak in tongues and then people are going to judge me. No, it's not that at all. But I'll tell you this, is the hunger of your heart is what you're going to allow the Lord to do in your life. If you shut it off, of course, it's not going to happen in your life. But if you open up your life to say, more of you, Lord, all of you, Lord, whatever it is that you want from me, I'll take. I'll have. I want it. I promise you, your life will change. In this moment, those that are at the altar, come on, what's your hunger for the Lord? After you have that time of repentance with the Lord, and you feel like he's cleansing your heart, then all you got to do after that is say, Lord, I want more of you. Come on, the hunger of your heart. And in the time of your prayer, once you're at a point where you say, you know what, Lord, I want more of you, stand to your feet. And as I walk by and ask the Holy Spirit who to pray for, I say, Lord, just give them more of you. That's all I'm going to say. Lord, give them more of you. Fill them up. That's it. Once you're at that place, stand to your feet.
Show me your glory. I want to know you more. I want to see you. Show me your glory. I want to know you more. Show me we want to know you. I invite everyone who are not being prayed for. Is there anyone or core? Let's sing that He is holy. You are holy. Tell Him that He is holy. Just follow me.
Singing.
Spirit is moving at this place. Don't get distracted. Focus on Him. Sing it.
Singing, You are whole. You are holy. You are so whole. Oh,
Well, everyone, I hope that you got to receive what you needed to receive from God. You know, something that I hope that you can learn is this, is that if you can meet God in his presence and have a true encounter with him, things change. Your life can change. Everybody in this room, I'll say it again, you can play church games all you want, but you will never have a real encounter with him like how you're having right now. And I praise God for what he's been doing in y'all's lives right here. I thank God for the true encounters that y'all have had. It's not the end. Just know this, guys. I'm in the same boat as you. I've said the same prayers that you're saying right now. And guess what? It wasn't years ago. It was just a month ago. It was just last night. Lord, use me. Lord, use me. I'm nobody without you. I want to be used. I want to bring this to my youth group. I want to lead and all these. I'm saying the same prayers as y'all. That's the heart that God's looking for. Those that want to be used by him. So be used. I hope y'all are blessed. Go back to the hotel or to the restaurant that you want to go eat at or whatever, but come back ready to be filled by God even more tonight. I love you guys. I hope to get to know y'all a little bit more. Tomorrow we'll have another service, but we'll be over in the CLC. It'll be probably a shorter service with acoustic worship and then just a time that we can fellowship, play some volleyball or spike ball or some games. And I'm looking forward to getting to know you guys a little bit better. So see y'all later.